Okay, fine. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So,
Thank you.
yeah. So today we will talk about the reduced side join. So as I've explained in the earlier classes that we have, 1 minute. My machine has,
Some,
yeah.
Yeah. Some, you couldn't find the recordings, right? One or two recordings were missing, right?
Yeah, I'm. Yeah, so as we know in MapReduce, there are two kinds of join. One map side join, and what second is reduce side join. But the difference, no one, I mean, if anyone asks you the difference, then what exactly needs to be said, that when, what is the difference in map side join and the reduced side join? Joining here, it means that joining is a traditional, I say it's in a traditional word, it means that you are joining in traditional RDBMS world. When you say join, that means you are trying to join the two data sets to get some results. So here, joining means combining, it's the same thing, combining are using two different data sets okay. Now map side join means that the two different data sets to obtain, okay, let me say combining or using two different data sets to obtain the final result. Now this final result, when we say it's a map side join, that means this final result is already available in the map side. Okay, the final result is already available in the map side. You don't require any reducer for that. You don't require reducer. The result is available on the mapper side. The result is available after the map phase is completed. Okay. So that's why the map side join, that's the map side join. In the reduced side join, the data is available is through a usually MapReduce job. Means it's not the data, it's not, you should not say that the data sets joined at the two data sets joining happens at the reducer side. It's a normal MapReduce job which will result into joining. So reduce side join is nothing but it will be a normal MapReduce job. Okay. And when you say, so sometimes it gets confusion that when you join it, so you will be running MapReduce job only on one data set. Here you should understand that MapReduce job will be running on both the data sets. Will be running on all the data sets. Because they can join, why I'm saying all, the reason is you can, the joining can happen in more than two data sets. So if joining is happening in more than two data sets, so in the normal, I mean to say in the reduced side join, you are going to run the MapReduce job on all the data sets. Now when we should, when now the, now the next question is when we should go for a map side join and the reduced side join. So that is explained. I'm just explaining again, once again, this has already been explained in the previous classes. So when we should go for, or which join should be chosen. So it depends on the data set. So how do, which joining technique should be chosen, or so how do you choose that whether I should go for a map side join or the reduced side join? So let's say you have a data set D1 and the dataset D2. You want to join these two datasets and want to produce some result. Now, here you will go for a map site join if one of the datasets you are joining is smaller in size. You will go for, or you should go for, map site join if one of the datasets you are joining is smaller in size. For example, this is your employee dataset. The same example I have taken for the map site join, and this is your location dataset. Let's say the employee dataset size, the size of the employee dataset is 1 terabyte, and the location data is somewhere around 50 MB or 100 MB, which is very much smaller than the employee dataset. Or I would say that the data set is the location data set. The size is so small that it can be held in the your mappers or in JVM's memory. 1 terabyte it cannot be held in JVM's memory because you normally don't have 1 terabyte of JVM options, right? You generally have around few gigabytes something. I hope you remember minus XMX. That's your maximum size of the JVM. Let's say it's a 3 gigabytes minus XMS, that's a smaller, somewhere around 256 MB. So what we are assuming that the data set, the smaller data set is small enough to store in your JVM's mappers or in tasks or JVM's memory. So you should go for a map site join if one of the data sets you are joining is smaller than size. So if D1, if location data is very much smaller than the employee, then you should ideally go for a map site join, and you actually refer the distributed cache video to see that how we can go for a map site join. Now the second is, you should go for a reduce site join if the data sets cannot fit into JVM's memory. Then you should go for reduce site join. So the name reduce site join is nothing but you are going to run the MapReduce job, normal MapReduce job. So reduce site join, the name, it does not mean any kind of a special join. It's just a normal MapReduce job. Is that clear? So don't get confused here that it is some kind of a different technique which I have to employ. It's a normal MapReduce job, and you will see that reduce site join is like a implementation or secondary sorting. So secondary sorting implementation. So you will, if secondary sorting concepts are clear, so then the secondary sorting, whatever the secondary sorting techniques, like you have a custom key, custom value, custom partitioner, that will come into play in the reduce site join also. Now let us try to understand today that what do we mean by reduce site join and how we're gonna solve it. Let's say we have a location data set. We have an employee data. Employee data has three fields: first name, last name, and location ID. An example could be XY IN India, AB UK. So and so forth, and then you have a location data. Just give me a moment, guys. Just give me 1 minute.
Hello, auntie, name funny, what is Japan?
So now, so what I was explaining here, that let's say we have an employee data which has three fields, a first name, last name, and location ID. First name, let's say X, few example could be X, Y, Y could be your last name, IN, location ID, which represents India, A, against few examples, A, B, UK, okay. And let's say you have a location data, and location data has two fields, which is location ID and the location name. Location ID, IN, and the location name corresponding is India, UK, and United Kingdom. Correct. So you have those mappings in this location file. Now here, what we are assuming as a part of the reduced size join is both the data sets are big. When I say big, that means to say that they are very big enough not to be accommodated in your JVM's memory. So I'm just assuming that it's very big, 300 gig, something like that. Now, how do you actually join the data set? So if you remember the problem statement is remains the same. The problem statement is you need to replace the location ID of every employee record with the corresponding location name. Replace the location ID of every guys, are you there? Hello?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You need to replace the location ID of every employee record with the corresponding location name. Yeah. So, which means that the final output of our MapReduce job should look like this. You have X, Y, X, comma, Y, IN should be replaced by India, A, comma, B, comma, UK should be replaced by the corresponding location name, which is United Kingdom, and so on and so forth. For all the employees, the location ID should be replaced. Now, we are assuming that the both of the data sets are very big, they cannot accommodate in a single JVM's memory, hence map side join is not an option for us. We have to go for a reduced side join. As I've told you, that reduced side join is nothing but a normal MapReduce job. So here we're gonna run the MapReduce job on both the data sets together. So that's what I'm saying. So in if you have understood the map side join first, so you will run the MapReduce job only on one of the data set, and the other data set you keep in memory using the distributed cache. So if the location data is smaller, and so let me just quickly explain this. So here, let's assume that location data is smaller. So here, location data is smaller. Let's say it's a very small. So in the map side join, if location data is smaller, you will run the MapReduce job on employee data set. And location data is made available to all the mapper tasks via distributed cache. So that's a concept which we have learned earlier. Now, what we are saying in the reduced side join, both the data sets are very big. So in this case, you will run the MapReduce job on both the data sets. What will you do on HDFS? You will create a directory, and then you push and you put this both this data set. Your employee data set and the location data set. And this will be the input to your MapReduce job. Now, to solve this problem of replacing the location ID of every employer record with the corresponding location name, now since you know that, now here you have, now here you have the scenario that you have to write the, you have to run the MapReduce job on both these data sets. Now, as we know how to write the MapReduce job, the first task is to choose the map tasks and the reduce task. Choose the mapper map output key, map output key value pair, right? So what should be the output key value pair from the mapper? What should be my output key and output value to solve this problem? In the first go, I figure it out that, okay, employee data has three fields, okay, location data has two fields, and everybody and now we understand that the map task receives one record at a time, and in both of them location ID is the common. So what I'm gonna do, if employee record arrives in my map phase, you cannot have a multiple mapper class for different data set, right? So you will have one single mapper class which will be dealt with your different data sets. So if employee record is coming, my output key value pair will be the location ID, and my output value, let's say, is an employee record. Combination of your first name, it could be a string or a text, first name, last name, and location ID. That could be a string or a text, but this is my key. If location record comes, then my output key will be the location ID and my output value would be the location name. So for example, from my mapper, we know that we will be drawing a quick diagram to understand whether it gives us the correct result or not. So I will be drawing something like this. So this is my first step, that I decide the output key value pair from the mapper, and the second step being the draw the diagram to understand whether the whatever you have chosen is giving correct result or not. Now if I have this particular record, yeah,
sorry, I have one question. So it means that once we feed the it's input data, so we will be feeding both the input and out both the data sets to both mapper and reducer, and that's why we have to make distinction.
Just one minute. Give me a minute. Someone is calling me. Give me a minute. Hello, Vipin, you are asking something.
Yeah. Actually, so if I understood you correctly, so we are using both the data sets simultaneously for on map side and reduce side. Unlike, you know, for example, when we had.
Okay, in the, you are saying on the
you
map.
Got my, side, what yeah, I'm just saying.
In the map side problem, in the reduce side problem, we are using the same data set, right?
Yeah, both our data sets. Because, you know, if previously we were using word count for an example, so. Whenever we used word count problem, to usme to ek hi word data set hota tha. So which had the same format. But here we have two different data sets and each will be having different format.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah. Correct. Hmm.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. So now you have, the first step is to get the mapper, and the second step is to draw the diagram. So if this is the location record which is coming, to my mapper, then my output key value pair according to this logic would be IN and some employee record. IN, it could be another employee record. IN is nothing but first name, last name, location ID, something like that, right? There can be lot of INs, lot of employees that can belongs to Indian region. Now I'm just taking one example, and then somewhere you will get also IN as India, because you are also processing this location data. So you will also get IN India, correct. So now you have all this. So you know that once the mapper is done, all the key value pairs goes to your reducer. So in the reducer, you have a group by key operation. So the key here is IN, and then you have a group by key operation, which is E1, E2, E3. It could be India here, and then there can be E1 million. E1 million. Now this is the key and the list of values, which is a result of your grouping operation, and this will be the input to your reducer. So here now my input to reducer is key was my IN, that is my location ID, and the list of values E1, E2, E3, and India. India, and then you have E4, E1 million. This is my key, and iterable list of values. Now this goes to your reduce method, reduce, and in the reduce method, how would you replace the location ID of every employee record? Because even if remember that has a EN, I mean to say IN has location ID. Now you will first get this value. When you iterate over the list of values, it's an iterable list of values. If you remember that, let me just say string key, comma, iterable. Not, it's not a string, it's a text. Iterable text values context. Now you iterate over this list of values. Now, when you know in the iteration, you don't get all the values. You have to use the iterator to get that, or iterator, or you use a, you will get values one by one. Now, let me just say for text val colon values. That means I am iterating over these values. In the first iteration, I get E1, but can I, do I know what is my location ID when I get the E1? No, I don't know, right? So I will put this E1 into an array list. Let's say this is my array list. I'll put this E1 here. Now in the second iteration, I get E2. Again, I don't have the information that what is my location name for the corresponding key. So I'll again put E2 in my array list. The third iteration, I get E3. I'll again push into my array lists as because I don't have the location name information. Now in the fourth iteration, I get India as my location name. Now I know that I have received it. So all the further employees which I encounter, their location IDs will be replaced by this location name. And the previous one which are there in the array list, they can also be replaced. So our job is done. So I hope this is clear, right?
Yes, Om.
Yeah. Now, the situation could be much more simpler if I have the situation. If I have the array and the list of values. If this key and the list of values comes like this. So this is the first scenario where the list of values has in third place. The best case scenario would be if my location name comes at the first position. Very best scenario, because in this case I don't have to store anything in the array list. Now the worst case scenario would be E1 million, and then at the last you are receiving India. So in this case you will end up storing 1 million employee items. You need to store or save 1 million employee objects, and you might not able to store the 1 million employee objects because you might not have that memory. Is that clear?
Yes, Soom.
Yeah.
Soom, so One question here. So in both the cases, like we would be having the location name only once, right? It cannot be multiple times. Correct?
Yeah. So but then yes, of course it has to be once. And you remember that even if it comes at twice, it does not matter to you. You need only once, right?
Yeah.
It does not matter to you even if it comes twice or thrice or four times, because the location name will never change. Anna? Is that clear?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hmm. Now why this situation, why I have taken three scenarios? The reason is I am not sure about the values position, right? We have taken three such scenarios because we don't know the ordering of the values. Because we know that in the MapReduce job, which is sorted, values or key or values? Keys are sorted, right? Values are not sorted. Now, if this is the case, then I wanted a permanent solution that it never fails. So I wanted to achieve something like this. This is my best case scenario. And we wanted to achieve something like this. Which means that what I'm talking about is to sort the values in such a way that the location ID always comes at the first position. So sort the values in such a way that not location ID, I'm very sorry, that location name always comes at first position. And when I'm talking about sorting the values, it's nothing but we are going to use secondary sorting technique. It's a technique which uses to sort the values, and it starts with having a custom key. And the moment you talk about custom key, you need to write the custom partitioner. The moment you start the key, right? The moment you talk about customization keys, everything has to be changed. Custom key, custom partitioner, custom sorting comparator, custom grouping comparator, etc. I mean to say only four things are there, right? In the MapReduce job. So you need to end up changing everything.
One question here. So if you don't consider the secondary sorting technique, so whatever you have explained before that, is that the concept of reduced join, right?
Yeah, that's but you are always dependent on the values. It might fail one or the other, maybe one or two times, but it also might pass. If you go the way which I have just explained. But if you always want to pass it, you have to go this way.
So it means reduce side join and secondary sort technique, they work kind of hand in hand, right?
No. Secondary sorting is a technique. Okay. And reduce join is an implementation of that. It's a concept. And the reduce side join uses secondary second. You reduce side join uses secondary sorting. We have problems like a TF-IDF is an... Again, we will use secondary sorting. So it's like an algorithm, and we are using this algorithm here and here. Don't say that they work together side and side, okay? It's a technique wherein it's a technique to sort the values. Secondary sorting is a technique to sort the values along with the keys.
Okay, so if I understood correctly, secondary sorting is a technique to sort the values. And we can use it in the implementation of reduced side join.
Yeah. TF-IDF problem we will use it. Okay. So that's actually, so secondary sorting is reduced side join. Now, what we have to do is to sort the values in such a way the locationary always comes at the first position. It's a sorting, right? So sorting means you have a compare to method or the sorting compare. You just need to think about that appropriate logic. And the logic which I'm going to present right now, it is applicable for most of the cases. So I will make a custom key. So custom key will have two variables. One is the location ID, which is of, let's say, of type text. Another could be another is a Boolean variable, which say record type. It is my Boolean variable. This Boolean variable, of course, it can take only two values. One is false. False means zero. Excuse me. False. And this would be record type. This would be for the location records. Location records. When I'm processing the location records, when I'm forming the key value pair using the location record, that time the record type will be false, and true, the one, it will be for the employee records. That means the key value pair is formed using the employee records. That's why the record type I have used. Now I can have my custom value first, it which has a first name, which has a last name, and the location name. Now this is my custom key and the custom value. How do I form my key value pair? Now when this particular the employee record is coming up, x comma y comma in, then my custom key ck would be in comma, that is my member variable, and since it's an employee record, I will be making it as a true. And my custom value, this is my custom key, okay? My custom value is my first name is X, last name Y. I don't know the location name. I will make it as a null or an empty. Let me make it as an empty. Okay, now if this particular record is coming up from location record, that is in comma India, then my custom key would be in, and since it is a location record, I will make it as a false comma. My custom value would be, it does not have the first name, so let it be null or empty. Let it be null or empty, but the location name is India. Now remember that whenever the two keys, the comparison, the sorting happens only on keys, not on values, right? Secondary sorting, we do something in such a way with respect to the key so that the values are sorted. Now when these two values needs to be sorted, now assuming there are only two keys, this is the key and this is the key, and if these two values needs to be sorted in such a way that this guy should come up first, then we need to do with something with the keys. Now I mean the key should be formed in such a way that if we compare the two keys, automatically the values should be sorted. So what I want here, when I compare these two key value pairs, this particular key value pair should be at the first position, because it has which information? It has location name information. Should be at first position. This is what we have discussed. Should be at first position because it has location name info. And that's what we have discussed. And this should come second. So how do we do that? Since you know that sorting happens only on keys, and these are the keys which we have formed here.
I got a doubt here. Because when we say primary sort, there we are saying that the comparison is based on the keys, and the secondary sort, there we do the comparison based on the values. Is this wrong? The second statement.
Secondary sort is nothing. It's a technique. It's a technique to sort the values. By default,
okay,
you need to, whenever you want to sort the values, you will do something with the keys, because you cannot change the sorting technique. The sorting will only happen on keys. But then you customize your key. You form a composite key. The moment you form the composite key and all, that becomes a secondary sorting, because the sorting technique will change. So you see that here, there is no primary sort and secondary sort. There is only one sort, which happens only on keys. Whether it could be a custom key, it could be a normal key and all, whatever you have been using. So it's a custom key, which is a combination of your text and the Boolean variable. So you have to write a compare to method, which if two custom keys, how two keys of this type will be compared in such a way that the one which has the location name will be at the first position.
Okay, so it means no matter what kind of sorting we are doing, the sorting is based on the keys. It is just the behavior which we change, correct?
Yeah. So you will write your compare to method. I'm just explaining the compare to method. Public integer compare to, and you have a custom key k2, and you have a this pointer, right? So if, what do you say? What is the member variable if location IDs are same? So if this dot location ID equal to not like this. I should not do like this. I am just writing a minimum. This will not be written like this. I'm just writing a normal thing. K2 dot location ID. What I'm trying to say here, and if the location IDs are same, then compare your this dot record type dot compare to k2 dot record type. So when you compare this, so it will return the values. If you see the custom keys and custom values, it will return three values: -1, 0, and 1. 0 means they are equal. -1 is this is less than k2. And 1 is this is greater than k2. K2 is here. So based on this comparison logic, the key value pairs which has the location name first will be at the first position, because I deliberately kept the record type as a false. When you compare 0 and 1, so it will return -1, because 0 is less than 1. So that's how you have to do the secondary sort, reduced side join. Yeah. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to upload this video today, and I want you to spend some time in understanding, and tomorrow I will show you how to write the code.